On September 8th, 1966, the premiere episode of Star Trek aired and forever changed the science fiction landscape. Its creator, Gene Roddenberry, envisioned a more enlightened future, where humans and other species have evolved past prejudice to find a way to coexist. Roddenberry, being a liberal humanist, built the world of Star Trek to reflect his beliefs by not only creating a diverse cast, but also creating complex storylines that dealt with current world and social issues under the guise of science fiction. He would be quoted as saying, "Star Trek was an attempt to say humanity will reach maturity and wisdom on the day that it begins, not just to tolerate, but take special delight in differences and ideas and differences in life forms." When looking back at the original series, it's easy to see his vision, especially how the topics of race in the show parallels the events of happening in the world at the time of its release. But how do The Next Generation, Deep Space Nine, and Voyager measure up to this? Do they succeed or do they fall short? Roddenberry sadly passed away in 1991 while The Next Generation was in production. So it was really up to the show's creators to decide if they wanted to carry on this vision of an open-minded future. With that said, let's delve in into these first four series of the franchise to see how well they parallel topics of race in history and what they got wrong. As stated before, Star Trek the original series debuted in September of 1966. The 60s was a turbulent decade in history, and the United States saw itself in the midst of it all. Not only was the US in the middle of the controversial Vietnam War, but we were also dealing with the Cold War, the counterculture movement, the space race, and the civil rights movement. With most Americans owning a TV by this point, these events played out in everybody's living rooms every night on the news. On the surface, Star Trek was seen as an escapism for audiences, but deep down, it was much more. It was a commentary on the world and what it could be like in an enlightened 23rd century. Many elements of the show paralleled or were an answer to what was happening in the world at the time. The civil rights movement was one of the defining elements of the 1960s, and the show reflected this through its casting. Lieutenant Uhura, played by Nichelle Nichols, was a very important character because she allowed audiences to see an African-American woman defying the stereotypical roles that were typically seen on TV at the time. In her prominent position on the bridge of the Enterprise as the communications officer, she was seen and heard regularly, thus making her an integral part of the crew. Lieutenant Sulu, played by George Takei, was also important in showing the diversity of the 23rd century. With the Vietnam War underway and in World War II, fresh in people's memories, Sulu's presence as the helmsman on the Enterprise states that the future society has moved past any negative sentiments for Asian communities. Sulu's role also defied stereotypes seen in Asian characters at the time. While both these characters were important for diversity, and both Nichols and Decay were allowed to create aspects for their respective characters, there was not a whole lot of character development or conversations concerning race surrounding their characters. One could speculate that this could be due to Roddenberry's envisioned future where racism among humans is no longer an issue. While there were episodes where Uhura and Sulu were featured and did things that were very vital to the mission, the topic of race would take place through the typical science fiction allegory, the alien. We would see this mostly through the character Spock, who represents someone who is multiracial by being half human and half Vulcan. Played by Leonard Nimoy, Spock would, throughout the series, struggle with both aspects of his identity, mostly trying to suppress his emotional human identity in favor for his non-emotional Vulcan identity. In the famous episode, The Naked Time, Spock fights the effects of a virus that lowers his ability to control his emotions and at one point has an emotional outburst. This would be one of the few times we would see him show his human side of his identity. Spock striving to fully pass as Vulcan would be a continued character arc that would develop through the series and well into the films. Even with Roddenberry's utopian idealistic future, racism, at least towards aliens, was still a thing. It was usually directed towards Spock, either from other aliens or from the ship's medical doctor, Dr. McCoy, played by DeForest Kelly. Dr. McCoy, in almost every episode, makes some quip about Spock regarding either his Vulcan heritage or his logical thought process, which was always played off as friendly banter. It's interesting that Roddenberry would write lines such as these, given his ideas of a more accepting mindset in the future. In fact, many things about the original series contradict his envisioned future. I can't touch on all of them here, but one of the biggest ones is the Klingons for many reasons. The Klingons were originally an allegory for the Soviet Union, which makes sense that they would be the reoccurring villain for the show. That and stories that included them fed into the fears audiences had surrounding the Cold War. However, the Klingons were problematic due to the makeup choices made to portray the characters. White actors donned Asian-inspired facial hair and copper paint to darken their skin. Not only is this cultural appropriation, but it falls under the trope that people with dark skin are associated with being bad or evil. This would be cited as choices made due to budget limitations, but still, other choices could have been made. The look of the Klingons would change for the 1979 Star Trek The Motion Picture and continue from then on. However, with this change, they are still problematic, which is something I will touch on in a minute. On September 28, 1987, Star Trek The Next Generation premiered to a skeptical audience. At this point, fans had enjoyed four films starring the original cast, and many saw it to be sacrilegious to create a whole new series without them. But after the series gained traction, it became one of the biggest television shows at the time. As for the political climate during its seven-year run, we are seeing the end of the Cold War and the change in power in the White House. The 80s reflected a conservative sentiment on social issues with the dismantling of many civil rights programs and the push from the Reagan administration to end affirmative action. Unfortunately, The Next Generation doesn't parallel any of these events. When it comes to topics about race and representation, The Next Generation really does fall short. It's not to say that the show wasn't progressive in its subject matter, but it seems to ignore any real racial issues by leaning into the science fiction trope of using aliens as an allegory to talk about race. We see this mostly with the character Lieutenant Worf, who is a Klingon, played by Michael Dorn. Worf struggles with his racial identity, much like how Spock does in the original series. Being Klingon and adopted by human parents, he struggles with being raised by humans and wanting to identify with his Klingon heritage. Episodes where Worf immerses himself in his Klingon culture are the ones where we see the most character development for him. However, I will point out, though, that in the first season, Worf possesses more Klingon traits, and as the seasons progress, this seems to lessen to highlight his struggle with his identity. Lieutenant Commander Geordi LaForge, played by LeVar Burton, is the only person of color in the main cast who plays a human. While this could have given many avenues to talk about race from a human perspective, the only topics surrounding his character have to do with his blindness. This, most likely, it has to do with Roddenberry's envisioned future, where racism is no longer seen as an issue. Even though the show doesn't address what it's like for Geordi to be a black man in Starfleet, who is also the lead engineering officer, his character does show the possibilities of what people with disabilities can achieve. In a season 2 episode called The Child, Guinan, played by Whoopi Goldberg, is introduced as the bartender of 10 Forward. Goldberg was inspired by Nichols from the original series and asked Roddenberry to create a guest spot for her on the show. This turned into a reoccurring role where at times she played a human-like alien that would provide wise insight for the main characters who needed some type of guidance. While her character falls under the wise black woman trope, some could argue that the episodes that featured Guinan are some of the best in the series. One element from the original series that carried over to The Next Generation is the appropriation of East Asian cultures and the use of makeup to darken actors' skin. The biggest example of this is the Klingons. As discussed earlier, Klingons went through many changes, one being makeup prosthetics to make them look more alien and menacing. However, their costumes and cultures take heavily from Mongolian and Japanese cultures. Another part of this is the makeup used to darken white actors' skin. Again, this falls under the trope of darker characters being labeled as antagonists, and even though Starfleet and the Klingon Empire are not quite enemies at this point, there's just no justification for white actors in dark makeup. Fans enjoy The Next Generation because of its progressive storylines and character development. However, when it comes to what the show parallels in the real world, it doesn't take a big enough stance on topics about race like the original series did, which is disappointing because there were so many opportunities to do so. On January 3, 1993, Star Trek Deep Space Nine premiered, overlapping the run of The Next Generation's last two seasons. The series is way ahead of its time with how it handled topics for many reasons. It would also be in contrast to the boldly go where no one has gone before motto of the previous two seasons due to the fact that the series takes place on a space station versus a spaceship. This gives it more of a Western feel in relation to the crew and how they handle the situations in every episode. The early 1990s saw issues surrounding labor and LGBTQ rights being brought to the attention of Americans, along with the availability of the internet and the beginning of NAFTA. Deep Space Nine took some of these topics along with social issues like racism and applied them to the world of Star Trek. The series wasn't afraid to delve deep into these topics while intersecting them with political topics such as imperialism, war, slavery, and genocide. Foregoing Roddenberry's idea of a future where social issues no longer exist, Deep Space Nine, while not perfect, really pushed the envelope. The series would present the franchise's first African-American captain, Benjamin Sisko, played by Avery Brooks. His character is groundbreaking because for the first time in Star Trek, the topic of race is told through the perspective of a human and not allegorically through aliens. While the show does use aliens to talk about race, Captain Sisko explores specifically what it's like to be a black man in Starfleet. A huge aspect of Sisko's character is how he is unapologetic about his ethnicity, and how it shapes his decisions as the commander of the space station and the Bajoran emissary. At the time, Deep Space Nine was the most diverse of any Star Trek show. Out of the nine characters, only four were human. This meant that many storylines centered around how these characters dealt with their racial identities. Odo, played by René Auberjonois, is a character who struggles with his racial identity. As a changeling who has no recollection of his past, he resents having to pass as a human to be able to function within the society of the space station. He also struggles with not knowing much about his heritage and wondering if he was the only changeling. In season 3, Odo not only finds his homeworld, but finds out his race is linked to the distress happening in that part of the galaxy. Upset by this, he realizes that his place is on the space station and not in his homeworld. Other characters, such as Dax, who is a Trill, played by Terry Farrell, struggles at times with memories of past hosts' bodies and what that means for her current host. When Worf joins the cast in the middle of the series, she becomes romantically involved with him, which is problematic when the host body dies and she must be transferred to a new host. Major Kira, played by Nana Visitor, is a Bajoran who has a strong connection to her heritage, which dictates her choices through the series. It could easily be said that she has the most character development throughout the series because of this. Her connection to her race also helps the audience understand the dynamics between the Bajoran and the Cardassians. The most problematic part of racial representation in Deep Space Nine are the Ferengi. Many fans over the years have linked their characters to anti-Semitism. However, the show's creators claim that it's an unfortunate coincidence. As a fan myself, I have to admit that I see what others see and find it disappointing because the show is so progressive, and for it to be spoiled with something like this is something that makes it hard to watch. With that said, out of the first four of the Star Trek series, this is probably the best because of the risks that were taken and the continued conflict and character growth throughout the series. On January 16, 1995, Star Trek Voyager premiered almost a year after the end of The Next Generation and 2 years into the run of Deep Space Nine. Because of the long overlap, the world issues of Deep Space Nine were the same for Voyager. However, I am hard-pressed to find any information on how Voyager paralleled any world events concerning race. It seems that instead, stories were more focused on gender equality and exploring humanity, which is great, but with a racially diverse cast and a story with the premise of encountering new life forms, this seems like such a missed opportunity given the fact that the crew is in a part of the galaxy that has not been explored by Starfleet. After being thrown across a Delta Quadrant, the Marquis and the crew of the Voyager joined forces on the 75-year journey back to Earth. Throughout the series, the two crews learn about each other and the different species they come across. However, for the viewer, it comes across as surface level. Chakotay, played by Robert Beltran, is the leader of the Maquis and the franchise's first indigenous representation. But we don't get to learn much about this part of him through the series. Episodes that do focus on his character end up by leaning on tropes, like having non-diegetic drums playing while he performs prayers. Tuvok, played by Tim Russ, is Star Trek's first Vulcan since Spock. Being a black Vulcan, we don't really learn much about this part of him. Instead, his character is more focused on not copying Spock. Also, his character mostly ends up being a confidant to Captain Janeway. Harry Kim, played by Garrett Wang, is Star Trek's first Asian American main character since Sulu. We don't get to learn about Harry's ethnicity at all during the series. This is mostly due to the fact that there is not a whole lot of character development for him. B'Elanna Torres is the only character who deals with her racial identity with any depth throughout the show. Being half Klingon, half human, she resents her Klingon heritage. That is, until she falls in love with Tom Paris and realizes if he can love her, so can she. The two characters who have the most development are the Doctor, played by Robert Picardo, and Seven of Nine, played by Jeri Ryan. Both characters struggle with wanting to learn to be human. This fits with the theme of the show because the crew's mission back to Earth and the fact that the trip will take them longer than their natural lifespans. Humanity is explored through these two characters. What makes us human, why we're limited, and what are we capable of are all issues they both deal with, which is universal. While the series is considered the least favorite by some fans, Voyager is still a good show and explores issues, it's just full of missed opportunities. In conclusion, Star Trek is a franchise that is not afraid to take risks and talk about issues that concern humans as a whole. The use of science fiction to explore topics surrounding race is a good way to talk about it because it allows other topics that intersect it to be discussed as well. Science fiction also allows storytellers such as Gene Roddenberry to talk about current world events in a way that puts them in a different perspective. Star Trek gives hope that someday humankind will find a way to embrace differences and celebrate humanity.